Good afternoon. Welcome back. I hope everyone had a lovely lunch. We are now in session two. The title is The Sweep of Science, Knowledge and the Nature of Reality. We are going deeper into the topics that we just began to open in our conversation this morning. We have four presenters during this period, which will run from 1 o'clock until 3:30. First, we will hear from Jinpa, whose microphone...
FM radio chi tanda tundu pyoge nala yinza kuch tati naro na kuch nga pyoge yuwe los okay sorry okay
so first we will hear from Jinpa and he will be building a bridge between Eastern Buddhist philosophy and Western science, building a conceptual bridge. He will be speaking in Tibetan to his colleagues, and we're all very eager to hear. Those of us who speak English have asked him to be sure to send us a copy of a translation of his talk when he has a chance. So he will speak for about 40 minutes. Then we'll hear from three scientists who will give an overview of the three major scientific areas in which we will be going tomorrow and for the next 3 days in greater depth. So first, from Arthur Zients, we'll hear about quantum physics. Then we will hear from John Durant about the history of neuroscience. You heard a bit this morning from Richie Davidson about neuroscience. John will put it in a historical context. And then we will hear from Wendy Hassenkamp about contemporary neuroscience. So it promises to be a rich session. And with no further ado, Jinpa.
You want to mention His Holiness, believe in
it. Oh, yes. Thank you. And we're so glad you are here, Your Holiness. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. His Holiness will be here until about 2 o'clock. So we'll have a little break so that he can exit, and then we will go on with our proceedings. So we're delighted you could join us. Thank you so much. Anything else?
Yep. Thank you, Diana.
His Eminence Gandhi Rinpoche to Shajang Rinpoche, Venerable Togos and Geshelas, and monastic students, and guests from the scientific community, and scientists, renowned scientists who have particularly today, historic remark, Mind and Life Conference 26 is being held at the Drepung Monastery, which is also known as the Nalanda of Tibet. Happy and feel privileged to get the opportunity to present here, particularly considering my own educational background as a student of Buddhist philosophy, one who has studied this tradition for so many years. I feel so grateful to get this opportunity. In this presentation, this presentation, which would be an introduction to the Buddhist traditionally believe should be given in Tibetan language. After having many discussions, we decided to have this presentation in Tibetan, particularly because I'll be introducing many scientific concepts, the scientific mode of inquiry and so on. And because I'll be talking about the Buddhist concept, it will be easier for me to present this in Tibetan. Initially, I accepted because I thought that His Holiness won't be present in this session. However, you know, His Holiness is here, and I feel as though I'm taking an examination in front of my my teacher, and I would like to offer my apologies if any limitations come into my presentation. As for my educational history, I attended modern school until fourth grade, and after that went into a monastery to study the traditional So initially, I joined a monastery and studied the traditional Buddhist teachings. So my stable diet, as you will be the study of Buddhist traditions. And my interest in science and study in Western philosophy and so on was inspired by His Holiness' interest in science and the need as a translator of His Holiness to engage in with scientific community and translate for His Holiness. And gradually I myself my interest in science and Western philosophy developed with such interaction with the scientific community. This morning His Holiness spoke about the subtle impermanence, where the momentariness of particles is displayed or explained in a very different manner in the through the scientific explanation. And having encountered such tradition helped me in my own understanding of many of the Buddhist concepts. And I personally, I would like to assert that through my various a number of years of interaction with scientific community, I didn't feel that the scientific concept and scientific method of inquiry do not pose any challenges to the traditional Buddhist mode of inquiry and so on. last summer at the Gelug conference, it was decided that the science education would be incorporated in the monastic academic tradition, now the as to the how we would provide this education to the monastic community, we had a number of discussions. It will not be same to provide education, scientific education, to the general school students as opposed to the monastic students, because the monastic students have already are already advanced in their own studies and have engaged in the study of epistemology and so on for a number of years. So therefore, teaching science to them would be the approach should be different from that or the approach that's utilized in the modern schools. I have noticed that there are many scientific literatures coming out of Tibet, and when you study that, there are several different approaches. One approach or one perspective is that in the old times, the Buddhist philosophers, Buddhist students, scholars, they studied the views of the outside non-Buddhist schools, and those who held this perspective view science as similar to a worldview of a non-Buddhist school, and they feel that there is need to study a scientific worldview in order to negate the scientific worldview and so on. So that's one perspective. The other perspective is that they hold the scientific worldview is exactly same as Buddhist worldview, and that we could use this scientific method of inquiry and scientific knowledge to prove the Buddhist concepts and Buddhist worldview. So these are two different approaches that they are taking up in order to inspire people to study science. However, I think there is a third approach which His Holiness propounds, in which we classify Buddhism into three different categories, where we have Buddhist science, Buddhist philosophy, and Buddhist practice. So this third approach is the middle approach, and my presentation would be based on the third approach. The first, I would like to highlight key differences between science and philosophy. My understanding is that science is, as His Holiness mentioned this this morning, that the science mainly focus on the empirical objects and study their nature and try to find the and develop theory and try to seek the general sort of a concept that's applicable to many different instances, and based on that they develop experiments and tests so as to develop new knowledge, seek new knowledge. And science continues to build on the knowledge that has been accumulated. Now, as for the philosophy, the object of investigation is not just the empirical. And they use the reasoning and logic to posit one's views and to challenge and critique other views. So that's the philosophical approach. Now we have to understand what science is, what is its definition, what is its nature. It's important to understand how science should be viewed, how science should be understood. So it's not science should not be understood just as it's a collection should not be understood as a collection of knowledge. Rather, it shouldn't be defined.
In the English slide here. And I'm sorry that I've chosen to speak in Tibetan, but you are hopefully receiving good translation. So the main distinction between philosophy and science, as I see it, if you can quickly read it, I'm not going to read it out.
If science is to be, if the important feature of the science is its method of inquiry, then what are the important features? The first is as the president of Mind and Life this morning said, His Holiness. Arthur talked about His Holiness' interest, His Holiness' use of a telescope to look at the moon. The first important step in the method is systematic approach, observation. And then the second step would be to develop a hypothesis based on the empirical data. The third next step is to test what the hypothesis one has developed, and the next any new findings that one gained through experimentation is used to develop to modify earlier previous hypothesis or build up new hypothesis and make predictions. The new hypothesis, whether that's valid or not, should be studied through once more experimentation. And verify or modify if a modification is needed, should be done accordingly. Another important part of the mode of inquiry of science is to seek the laws of nature, and here law refers to something that's applicable to a wide range of phenomena. And so laws would be something that's applicable to a lot of phenomena, can be generalized to a lot of phenomena, it could be seen as a summary of an understanding that's applicable to a wide range of phenomena. Now, to give two examples of laws of nature, first, I have Newton's law of universal gravitation. And it states that irrespective of the size of objects, you know, any two objects with mass would attract each other. And the fact that apple falls to the ground is because of this attraction that exists between the earth and the apple. The second example would be Newton's law of motion. And this law speak about the how motion is first, you know, the law of inertia, where any object would retain its state unless acted upon by an external force. And the second is the relationship between the mass and the velocity or the acceleration of an object. For instance, if a car is moving at a high acceleration, then its impact upon an object would be greater than an object that has a lower acceleration. His Holiness, as His Holiness talked about the four principles of reality this morning, so this morning His Holiness spoke about the four principles of reality, which he thinks has a very close resemblance with the scientific inquiry, mode of inquiry. Of the four, the first is principle of dependence. here the dependence could be viewed through two ways. One is through the causal dependency, and the other one is through the dependency of having similar nature. The second principle is principle of function, where each object would have its own function. And the third principle is the principle of nature, whereby we understand fire has the nature of hotness. So here we seek the nature of a particular thing as the final sort of arbiter. For instance, fire being hot. If one is asked the reason or explanation for that, you know, we'll just say that it's the nature of fire. And based on these three principles, the last principle, that is the principle of evidence, is developed. And here, based on the previous three principles, one draws inferences and conclusions. So because of this, you know, this happens, because of this, that happened. And this chain of inferences is based on the understanding of the previous three principles. For instance, if there is no tree, then they cannot be an oak tree, because, you know, the negation of tree would automatically negate the oak tree, the presence of oak tree. So as His Holiness mentioned this morning, we have to think carefully about the four principles and how these principles could be, how these principles are similar to the scientific mode of inquiry. Therefore, and And here to make clarification, Rigpa here does not refer to logic or reasoning, but rather it's Rigpa here means whether that's valid or not. So because of the various relations that exist between objects, try to understand, we study the relation between the objects, similarly in science, relations between objects are sought. So in the Buddhist understanding, one type of relationship is the identity, where if A is B, and the second relation is the contradiction, and within the contradiction there is one called law of the excluded middle, and then another type of relationship, an important relation, is the causal relation. So if two objects, if we seek relation between two objects, we seek either of these four relations. And in our traditional study, from a very young age, we the students are taught to seek the relationship between two objects, and there are four sort of possibilities of such relationships. And two objects having similar nature has a particular relationship that's that can be viewed as class and its member. So it is, I want to appeal to all of you to view science not as something completely, different from Buddhist philosophy, because the mode of inquiry, scientific inquiry, has many similar features with Buddhism. Then another important aspect is the form of inference, where you have different types of inferences. So we have a general causal inference, inferring a preceding cause, and then inferring a specific unobserved condition, where, for instance, an eye consciousness apprehending a form, the seeking the various factors, various conditions of something, for instance, eye consciousness. We experience the eye consciousness itself, and we know that there are the objective factor, they have the the fourth form of inference is the observance of a contrary fact. And science employs these particular, many of these inferences are employed in the scientific mode of inquiry as well. So, because of lack of time, I'm going to skip over some of these. And this morning, His Holiness made or specified one difference between science and Buddhism, where science engage in the evident facts. Whereas in Buddhist philosophy, three objects are identified. One is the evident facts. The second one is the hidden facts, and the third is the deeply hidden facts. Now, the hidden facts are those that has to understood, relying upon inferences and reasoning. Yet, it is clear that the inferences must finally must be based on an empirical evidence. Otherwise, you know, the inference will keep on depending on another inference. And so, therefore, the inference must finally be based on an empirical fact. And the third one is the extremely hidden facts, which depend on reliable testimony. So therefore, at this present moment, I don't see science employing this, science engaging in this object. But in future, that could happen where you invoke the testimony of scientists such as Einstein and so on. One thing that we need to make a distinction is between science and truth. If something is true, does it mean that science should be able to prove that? There are who hold a view that because all the phenomena ultimately should be that all the phenomena that we see must be based on physical material object. Everything should be able to science should be able to describe and explain everything, every phenomena. However, there are who feel that science will never be able to explain everything because science attempts to seek the laws that apply to
but the
so on this issue, two questions arise. If science proves something, then does it mean that so these two questions are important to keep in mind, particularly to know the boundary of science. For Buddhists, all things that exist are not necessarily material based. For instance, according to Popper, most of the scientific explanation are temporary explanation. The scientific explanation or statement should be able to falsifiable in that, you know, if the statement is false, then you know the science should be able to prove its falsity. Now, whether God exists or not, is outside the purview of science, because there's no way you can prove whether science, God exists or not. Similarly, Thomas Kuhn, in his Structure of Scientific Revolutions, science, in its approach to understand the nature, engage in observation and experimentations and so on, and as they go into finer and finer study, many of the previously held theories are proven wrong, and as this as a contradiction sort of compiles, it becomes, the burden of contradiction becomes too huge, that paradigm shifts becomes necessary. So this morning His Holiness spoke about the scientist as being unbiased, undogmatic, in that, you know, when a new finding is...
This is from Richard Feynman.
Giving these examples is to highlight that the relation between science and religion or Buddhism is not straightforward, but rather complicated. And the various inferences, the objects of knowledge, and so on. should be, you know, we should be able to apply these when you are studying science, you know, how these different modes of inquiries and inferences could be applied to, you know, scientific investigation and to your study of science. So the monastics should have your own stand, even when you're studying science, and use the scientific knowledge as a complementary. Similarly, the scientists, many scientists who are interested in Buddhist philosophy, they have their own standpoint. And
It's on?
Yeah. It's on. Yeah. Okay. Good. There's so many objects here, it's hard to keep track of them all. Excuse me. Thank you so much. That was fascinating and very important. We were scribbling notes even with the translation. And the basic message is there is no necessary conflict. It's the same message we heard this morning from His Holiness, from Arthur, between Buddhist philosophy and scientific procedure, because both are committed to systematic processes for getting at approximations of the truth with a clear understanding that there's always the possibility around the corner that some new evidence will arise that will challenge something you believe. Einstein was famous for having said, no experiment will ever prove me right. A single experiment can always prove me wrong. So there's a kind of commonality of approach and belief in that. It was a beautiful statement. Thank you very much. Your Holiness, is there anything you would like to say to your brilliant student colleague in response to this presentation, and then we'll move along?
Gave an explanation particularly about the mode of inquiry, the way we seek truth, and this is very important. So in terms of the consciousness, various explanations of the consciousness, we have the Abhidharma system. We also have a tantric system where various levels of subtlety of consciousness are spoken about. In the tantric texts, they talk about the necessity for straight physical postures, and in order to have a clear and straight concentration or thought. If your physical posture is straight, then the channels are straightened and the wind flows smoothly, and as such your mind would be clear and so on. About the consciousness and mind, the explanation of mind and consciousness. We have mind with the aspect and mind without the aspect. We may be able to engage in these more in later. So the way last year I remarked about this, Paul Ekman. Paul Ekman spoke about 16 different mental factors that are connected with anger that could be perceived on one's facial expression. In the lower Buddhist school of thoughts, 51 mental factors are spoken of. However, in those mental factors, there are many. There are many mental factors that are spoken in the tantric texts that are not explained in the lower school. So.
The sources are, in addition to the Abhidhamma sources, which is the primary source for Buddhist understanding of mind, there's also the Vajrayana, sources. And in fact, there is also an explicit recognition of the intimate connection between body and mind. For example, there is in the Vajrayana text, there's a statement which says that when emphasizing the importance of a good physical posture in meditation, it says if your physical posture is good, then it allows for the, and then the channels remain stand in their correct way, and when the channels remain strong, then the energy that flows within flows fluidly, and when that happens, the channel energy long.
Oh, energy.
And then when that happens, then the mental processes flow smoothly. So there is an explicit recognition of the intimate connection between physical states and mental states. And similarly, in Vajrayana tradition text, there are discussions about the various levels of subtlety of mental states. So all of these are very important resources. And in the Abhidhamma taxonomy, there are taxonomy of mental factors, 40, 46, 53, 51. And also, there's a large number of mental factors that are mentioned in the Vajrayana sources, which are not on the list of Abhidhamma. So, and His Holiness was saying that, in his discussion with Paul Ekman, where Paul Ekman has a taxonomy of some of these mental states based on his facial recognition. So it seems that there is a real fruitful, area here where there could be a fruitful interface. And on the part of the Buddhist scholars as well, we should not be dogmatic about the list that we have in Abhidhamma. Even within the Buddhist sources, there are divergent sources, and if that is true, then there is no reason why we cannot take on board very specific mental processes that are identified in the contemporary science.
That didn't shiva yulu jusu ti yulu tamna da do se ju chiksaro.
So then earlier I forgot that His Holiness also mentioned that in the epistemological text there have been a lot of debates about whether or not the perception mirrors physical reality or whether there is a form that is imposed by the mind when it perceives. And between the two, it seems to be the science seems to be kind of more in tune with the second standpoint, which is the mainstream position of the Buddhist epistemologist as well. And then there had been a lot of debate between the three possible ways in which the perception perceives the physical object. One is known as the splitting of egg into half. So just as when egg is split into half, you have identical two pieces, in the same manner when perception arises, basically you have an internal perspective, an external perspective. So it's like split into two. So that was one way of... the other one is just as, for example, if you are perceiving a multicolored object, just as there are a multitude of dots or colors in that object, so there are multitudes of percepts in the perception. Then the third one was that although there might be a multitude of colors and things, shapes in the object, but when the perception arises, it's a more a single perception. So again, the Western science, at least the cognitive science, to be favoring more the last standpoint, which is again the mainstream standpoint of the Buddhist. So there seems to be, and then another area, His Holiness mentioned, is that in the Buddhist epistemological, there's a lot of discussions about the different mode of engagement of perception versus thoughts. So perceptions are more immediate, direct, unmediated in that sense by language and concepts, whereas thoughts are always mediated by some kind of construct. So there's a lot of discussion of that. And again, that's could be a fruitful area of
dialogue.
And then similarly, in the Buddhist epistemological text, there's a distinction made between mode of thought that engages the object primarily by means of exclusion of something, rather than a direct kind of, you know, more affirmative or positive, you know, content. So again, that seems to be a possible area. So His Holiness feels that given that phenomenologically each of these different modes of engagement are quite distinct, you know, whether or not there is an expression of that at the brain level would be an interesting question.
I hope you see someone, because guinea pig is like, it's a guinea pig.
Guinea pig.
Guinea pig. Nickname.
Nickname
guinea pig. So, you see, someone firstly train the ability recognize during dream. Now I mean dreaming. So through that way, actually, you see, the dreamer can control dream. And then dream time, you see, meditate and some sort of practice dissolution.
Dissolution, yeah.
So perhaps eventually we find that kind of, because of guinea pig, then investigate what changed their brain. I think these are, I think, very, very important. That's the thing that the sound. The gawa the tinji the chishir zane mojilo dokche che sadi kashi re mojilo doga ta desa
naren
tegi de shema so
ye mari
ti chenme na shigu do shigu do
ti chere na la peje min do dande chal chena
ta do modi be na la chi de shira she de chi ten she sa ji
naren
ta chi be jang so bur chi shi sam da chi de she go ba ta sa ji be di ga ma ba ta chen ji be chi ka ma na ji mi de ge
Chip, So another insolence was referring to my presentation where I talked about the relationship between the universal and the particular. And so there has been a lot of debate in the classical Indian tradition on the whether or not there are such thing as real universals. The non-Buddhist tradition there, on the whole, tends to postulate a presence of independent real universals, which are then instantiated, whereas the Buddhist position really has been a rejection of independent or real universals. But at the same time, one does have to talk about, you know, the general, you know, the universal, the generality, and their instantiated particulars. So what would be the relationship between that and what would be the ontological status of the universals? And furthermore, since we know from our own kind of understanding that you know, there could be a single object, but we can speak about many different attributes of that object, but in reality and in actual fact, there is only one thing there, but we can speak about its color, its shapes, and so on. So what about all of these attributes that are part of that? So in Buddhist epistemology, there's a discussion about, you know, facts which are identical in nature, but distinct in terms of their identities. So again, whether or not that view can have a place in science is another interesting question.
Yes, Your Holiness. We have gone over time a little bit, but this has been a very, very fruitful conversation. I'm struck you are constantly generating these questions that are extremely interesting, research questions, and it reinforces your interest in education, because we need to educate many people who can work on these questions you keep producing. We need a whole army of investigators. Thank you. And Jinpa, thank you very much.
Perhaps one joke I would like to mention, to express. Now I retired from political responsibility, so perhaps I may join the group of researchers.
You are very welcome, always. You make yourself a guinea pig? Control your dreams?
Yes, if highly necessary, then of course. Once or once in the past experience, one practitioner, although he he did not sort of specifically sort of because of that train about the inner heat,
Tumu.
No, huh? Dr. Benson or something, Herbert.
Herbert Benson.
Oh, Herbert Benson. So he brought to America and some kind of sort of experiments.
Oh.
Then the room where they carrying the experiment, very cold. So eventually that really causing some illness, that practitioner. So I do not want to do that. But fortunately, this guinea pig survived. No other problem, no side problem.
We treat him very well. Healthy guinea pig.
Healthy
guinea pig. Yes, now next.
Thank you very much. So next we will hear again from Arthur Zients. We'll change seats. And he will be making a presentation on quantum physics, so continuing in many ways where we left off this morning with his brief talk and giving us a kind of overview of this field and where it has come from and where it is now and how to think about it, this field of quantum physics, which is radically different from traditional physics.
Testing, 1, 2, 3. Can you hear me? Testing, 1, 2, 3. A little bit louder. There you go.
Okay. How was the translation?
Your Holiness, before we move on to quantum physics, I'd like to speak a little more about Galileo. Because Galileo not only looked at the moon and the planets and so forth, but he also was a student of nature on the Earth, the experiments on the Earth. And I'd like to speak about one very important experiment, one which also became part of Albert Einstein's general theory of relativity. And I would like to do this because Galileo uses reason. In some sense, purely reason. Is it possible to gain insight into the world purely on the basis of thought? And here we see an example of his reasoning in a way that is like your reasoning and the reasoning of so many here, highly disciplined, very careful, leading to conclusions that then one can test experimentally, but in thought, they are predicted purely on the basis of reasoning. Einstein was also such a figure who loved to think. I'm going to do it's a little hard to see on the screen over here. Can you pull it up on the screens to the left and to the right? But I'm going to demonstrate. Can you hand me one of those candies? Thank you, Christo. So I have two objects here. One is heavy and the other is light. Mm. This is very light, this is very heavy. I'm not going to do the experiment. I'm going to have you think about the experiment, namely if I were to drop these two. And the question is, how would they travel? Would one go fast and the other slow? Would they travel at the same speed? What will happen? And can one, through thought alone, determine and predict what will happen? So I'm going to show it on the screen here. One possibility is that the big one goes fast and the little one goes slow. Another possibility would be for the two to fall at the same rate. Right? Now, I could take a vote and try to see what you think. Will the will they go at the same rate, or will the little one go slow and the big one go fast because it's so heavy? All right, you all have made up your minds? Okay, now we're going to do a thought experiment. We're going to reason our way through this just the way Galileo did. He's going to say, let's take these two objects, the candy and the bottle, and we'll tie them together and make a third object. One which is the sum of the two, all right? Which is heavier still. It's heavier than each of the three, each of the two. Will it travel faster still, or will it travel at the same rate? You tie them together, right? So then you have one object, but is now still more massive, still heavier. And you might think it will travel faster. But what if you take a string, a very thin string, a very, very thin string, and you tie the two together really very, very thin? Do you have one large object, or do you have two objects tied with a string? Will the light one, which falls slowly, slow down the big one? Or will they be treated as a single object and fall quickly? You see? And he thought to himself, this is a kind of contradiction. The only way to avoid the contradiction is for them both to fall at exactly the same rate. And so he predicted... Okay, so what will happen is the two, one could fall fast and the other slow. You put them on top, you tie them together, you have one object that falls very fast. Or you take a thread, very thin, and you have now a light object and a heavy object. The heavy object falls fast, but the light one falls slow, and so it pulls and slows down
the big,
heavy object.
So, if the weight distinction difference between the two is big, then the string might snap.
Yes.
But that's then something's wrong.
Then something's wrong, right? Mm. So that's not the case. You could say, you take the two, you tie them together, you tie them together a little less, you tie them together a little less. When do you have two objects, and when do you have one object? You see the contradiction.
Yeah.
With two objects, you might expect the heavy to go fast. With one object, it goes very fast, right? But now you take this one object and you make it back into two objects step by step. What will happen? And so Galileo predicted, he said, the only way to get a consistent answer is for the small object and the large object to fall at exactly the same speed. No matter how light this is, this could be a grain of sand, and this could be a very big stone, you let them go, they have to fall at the same rate.
Leaving aside
friction. Leaving aside air resistance.
Which we're going to do. Resistance yong sigur. You korang ngone chungi tenshu gu dang ton chebe na.
Bena the air chun maybe airtight chebe jina du stevi na kachure.
So what about if you do the experiment in an airtight chamber?
Yes, if you do the experiment. Here's the experiment. The cats and the dogs run away. He describes
Tower of Pisa.
Yes, the Leaning Tower of Pisa. He describes this experiment of taking something light, something heavy, dropping them, and they arrive at the bottom at almost the same time. And the question of air is a problem. If there's air, then
that's
this
right,
doesn't work
that's
so
right,
well.
That's right.
If we take a Kleenex and drop it, it'll...
Yes, that's right.
But if we do this experiment on the moon...
That's right now.
If you do this experiment on the moon, there's no air on the moon.
That's right.
And I have a photo. I have a film of this experiment being done.
But you cannot say no air. So
very, very
little
air. You cannot say there is no air because there might not be the air that we are used to. But
well, if you
no?
go there, which we've gone there, right? We have traveled there. By spaceship, and you see up here is a image. See the images on the side. Here you have.
Better Mundgod, you call it air, it's man, is it? You call it real.
So, for example, on the moon, if there is no air of some kind, according to its own local kind of laws, how would you explain the emergence of these mountains?
Yes, but that is due to the heat in the center of the Earth.
Geology.
It's geology, heat in the center of the Earth, and that comes through two factors. One is the pressure.
That's
when you squeeze something,
so
very,
on moon
very,
also, that
also on the moon, it becomes very hot. And then you also have impact craters, right, into the surface, which then throws up huge amounts of soil and rock. And you saw those craters through the telescope, those round shapes, right? In the middle of this, you'll find a huge stone has come out of the sky or out of the space.
Just a moving side, and on top of it.
So, but there is some element of, some kind of atmospheric kind of, that allows the ability to move.
No, you don't need atmosphere to move. You can, and at least from the standpoint of modern science, you need just space. You don't need anything in the space.
It
can be completely empty. His Holiness is referring back to the Buddhist, physical theory, which postulates that the ultimate constituents of matter are really understood in terms of the four elements, which are really seen more as potentials rather than, but the potentials that allow matter to be solid, to have cohesion, which is the water element.
주어 가운데 소리 되지 아주 소리 세지 잘 놓쳐야 봐.
말에 대한테 소리 연구해야
돼. 사야 사야 좀 터지고 좀.
됐어요. Now. So it's the potential that makes it possible for material objects to have solidity. So that's the earth element. The potential that allows for the possibility of material phenomena, you know, objects to have cohesion, like kind of unity, that's water element and so on. So they're so really understood at a fundamental level, more like potentials. But His Holiness is wondering, so how would that theory apply to the moon if there is no air and no movement? Yes.
So from that level of very, very subtle air, subtle. Must be there. Otherwise, it's difficult.
Well, can one perhaps resolve the debate by saying there isn't enough air to breathe? So there might be a little bit of air, but there's not enough air to breathe, and the people that
that's not the air. That's right.
Yeah, that's fine.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
And that's all what you need for your purpose.
Yes. So if you're in intergalactic space, you know, you're in deep space, there's always a little tiny bit of air.
That's yours.
And other matter, other not just air. Air is a very particular kind of gas, a very particular kind of substance. Mm-hmm. But there are many others, but they're very, very, very thin. Yeah. And what they're thin enough is if you take a feather, or you take a piece of Kleenex, right, and you drop it in the air, it floats. If you take the same Kleenex and you drop it on the moon, and you drop it on the moon, it drops like a stone. And I have a movie of this that was taken in 1971 when the U.S. sent the astronaut David Scott to the moon with a friend who had a video camera, and they drop a hammer, very heavy, and a falcon feather. All right, the feather of a bird.
Visit.
Yeah, they're going to drop them, and you can see when they hit the ground. So if you'll watch the screen, I don't know if I can get the sound to work on this or not, but we'll try. Can the sound be turned up on my feed that's coming from the computer back there? I don't know if you have that together or not. Oh, let's go back again. There it is. Let's see. Did you notice how they hit the ground at the same time?
Gravity, chikurwa.
Chikuchiga.
Now watch them as they walk. See how they walk? They bounce around very slowly.
That's right, that's right.
Because the moon is so small that the gravity is very weak. And the things that they drop fall slowly and they themselves weigh very little. Right? Do you want to see that again?
No, it's okay.
It's okay.
Okay. No, this sounds correct.
Pardon?
Manzu, yang wat chi wat rejan jamar be. Rejan.
Lare, lung rejan.
Rejan mar be.
Rejan.
Yang wat chi wat.
Lare.
Lamme wat chi sa chi yang wat. Lare. Mar be. Rejan mar be.
Jamba, tsuba.
Ka.
Jamba, tsuba, yang wat chi wat. Ti rejan.
Rejan ba. Lam. Ti rejan shayad kare. Yang wat chi wat rejan shayad kare do.
Yes. Holiness is asking the Buddhist colleagues in the Buddhist Abhidhamma taxonomy, the quality of lightness is categorized as belonging to tactility, tactile property, and touch. And same thing goes for weight, heaviness.
Connected so to the sense of touch.
Yes. So His Holiness is wondering why that is the case. So he's asking the monastic colleagues.
I'm glad he's asking them and not me.
야우스 머주로 맞아. 걔 딜 나비다. 아주 아주 갈 쓰기 나스. 제 삼 다고 알았어요. 내 지난 세일과 계 책임이다.
His Holiness said that Jinpa did not translate it accurately. You know, he wasn't asking the scientist, but he was saying, what would we say? You know, the Buddhists.
What would the Buddhists say? Yes.
So this is just a fact. We
it's
can
a fact,
see.
Yeah.
Like that. Oh. So it's all kasoda.
Gravity.
Chazanga, yango de chio se di di kore kasoda. Yang jisse kore gan halam halam shia mebe. Yang so chado. But the regular shia di kaso dami na so chado di.
So Zolinus was saying that what this seems to imply is that actually the property of heaviness and lightness, you know, seem to be again contextual. You know, judging by this,
yes,
you know, we cannot accept them as intrinsic properties of the things.
That's very, very important.
So the Buddhist scholars, particularly the scholars, you know, should not just rest at ease from the statements found in the text, but actually should subject them to inquiry further to try to see what was the underlying reasons for making such and such statement or attributions.
Yes.
In fact, when there was a landing of the moon, His Holiness showed a photograph of the landing of the moon to one of the monastic colleagues by the name of Geshe-rabden in Dharamsala. And you know, he said maybe they ended up landing somewhere in the corner of Mount Meru. So for example, if one is that dogmatic and, you know, kind of obstinate, then it would be very difficult.
Yes. Well, this is an experiment I wish Your Holiness could make. You know, you looked at the moon when you were 10. Maybe now that you're a little older, you travel to the moon on the next spaceship.
Yeah. Yes.
So this equivalence, this fact that the two drop really at exactly the same speed, exactly the same rate of acceleration, we call it, has very, very widespread consequences, you know, and it's all the way into the modern physics, into the work of Albert Einstein, who likewise thought deeply about exactly this same issue. And from his reflections on this experiment, he came to the idea of his so-called general theory of relativity, his most profound contribution to physics, which really helps us to understand the largest aspects of the cosmos, the stars, the galaxies, and all of the rest. And this is from pure thought. Einstein did no experiments. He thought consistently. The way he characterized his thinking about this was what he said was his happiest thought, namely of falling out of a chair. Where you fall out of a chair, you become the bottle that's falling, and you ask, what is gravity? Is it different than acceleration? And he came to the insight that these two things, gravity, which pulls us down, and acceleration, which speeds us up, have a very, very intimate relationship. They are, in some sense, the same. So this is Galileo to Einstein. The power of human thought is extraordinary. So in some ways, you already have the laboratory. You have the laboratory right here, and you've been working with it for centuries, and it is powerful in ways which, even in the physical world, even in physical world, can be demonstrated and proved by these experiments. I wanted to end. You've already seen some of these pictures, so I'm going to skip those. And what I'm going to do is speak just for a few minutes about another aspect of physics. You talked about the elements of the Buddhist way of thinking, the Buddhist thought. you probably know that in the ancient Greeks, here in the West, they likewise had four elements.
Right.
Earth, water, air, and fire. Plato saw them actually as geometric forms, but we won't go into that. In modern science, we usually take the stance that we should look ever more precisely, ever more exactly, at smaller and smaller aspects of the things which constitute our world. So we look through a lens, the kind of lens that you might have in your reading glasses, and we see the object somewhat larger. You can take that same principle and create a microscope that's on the right, and the microscope makes what you see very much larger. So for example, if you take a leaf and then look through the leaf, you see on the right-hand side the magnification of the leaf cells, and then if you'd make it still larger, you can get the molecular structure of cellulose, and then you go into the actual components of that molecular structure and you find the atoms out of which that molecule is made. You can discover that there are about 100 of these primary elements. Each one has its own character. Some are gas, some are liquids like mercury, some are solids, some are explosive, some are non-reactive. And they're grouped here in a way where the common properties are all in the same region. So this is a kind of map, if you will, of all of the ingredients that make up our universe.
What would you say is the relationship between the elements table versus the Greek conception of the four elements? Are completely two distinct?
Well, they're distinct, but the perception of earth, water, air, and fire as components of the universe is very important. We would call them the states of matter, the first three: solid, liquid, and gas.
Yeah. Exactly the same.
Yeah, exactly the same.
So, what is the relationship between the periodic table element?
The relationship is that some of these here are solids. Some, for example, in this region in the middle, the ones at the ends, you can see, well, you can't see it very well, but these are all gases, for example. Certain ones are metals, so a particular type of solid. And they're put together here with these different colors to indicate their kind of families.
Related.
So this in relation to, say, for example, atoms, in terms of levels of reality, this is grosser than atom.
Elements can be, for example, here's what you would call the element of water. In our case, we would say it's a combination of hydrogen and oxygen together, and it's all water. It's all H2O. So you can have a lot of those atoms making up this volume, right? Inconceivably many. Each one of those elements there has a particular unique set of properties, you could say. You define each of these by its set of properties. Now we know that the properties which the chemists, the first chemists who came up with these different elements, we now understand this from the standpoint of still more subtle and smaller entities, electrons, protons, and neutrons, right? So you have the macroscopic world, it's analyzed into its elements. The elements each have unique set of properties. Then you can go and explain those properties from the standpoint of the structure of the atoms themselves. And then you can explain the inner structure of the nucleus by still more. This would take us a few more hours to get sorted out. But it's a wonderful success, you could say, story, which also, however, raises deep philosophical questions. Because if you continue this goal and you ask yourself, can I see atoms? Are atoms in some way palpable? One way of doing this is not by any longer trying to use light. Light is too primitive. It's not fine enough. And so what one does... So what one does is, you know, if you close your eyes and you feel something, you can tell its shape, even with your eyes closed.
Yes, that's right.
Yes. And if your finger is fine enough, it can feel the structure of your palm, your hand. And if you're trying to detect single atoms, then you need something which is extremely sharp, extremely pointed, very, very fine. And here in this diagram, you can see there's a tip. The tip is extremely fine, and then you bring it across a surface. The surface has a set of atoms, and then where it goes up and it goes down, you can make an image of this by computer, and you get the picture on the right. It's easier to see on these screens here. You see the picture on the right of the screen? It's produced
atoms
by running
always
your...
Moving one way.
Aren't the atoms constantly in motion?
Moving.
If they're cold and fixed to a solid, you can actually get them to have very little motion. Now, but you're right. Mostly the atoms in this air in our bodies are constantly in motion. But as you cool them down, that motion becomes less and less.
Heat up to what? Beyond what temperature?
Heat produces the motion. Heat is,
So His Holiness is wondering, in order for atoms to move, be in constant motion in their natural state, what level of heat would you need? I mean, how far you have to cool them down, in other words?
Yes, well, if you use Celsius, then you have to go 273 degrees is the end.
That's below.
Minus 273.
So what about if it goes really hot?
There's then no it's end to the really hot.
I see.
Then the atoms fall apart. But in the sun...
So in that case, for example, if we think of the atomic constituents of sun...
Of the sun.
Will that be the same in kind with the one that constitutes the earth?
Yes. The basic nature is same. Same atom?
It's the same, but in another state, because it is so hot. It's the same basic material, but extremely hot. And in the surface, you have certain gases.
So that means the atoms are in constant motion up
constant
in the sun.
Constant motion, yes. Very
but slower.
Motion. Fast movement.
Faster.
The surface of the sun, you know, could be at like 6,000 degrees.
Yes.
And as you go in, it goes into many, many, many thousands of degrees hotter still. Yeah, so it becomes so hot that you have what we call a thermonuclear reaction. It's like with the hydrogen bomb.
Right.
Inside the sun, we believe that the same processes are going on constantly on a vast scale, creating heat and light. Now, with all deference to my colleague, Richie Davidson, who says his topics are very interesting. I think our physics is quite interesting, too. Okay, now I have one last experiment. I don't know if you can see, but there's an arrow pointing to a person down at the bottom. That's a human being. And there inside the large hadron colliders, that's the detector for a single experiment, trying to determine the fundamental constituents of the universe. So you have a device, a piece of equipment that's larger than this building, and this is the equipment that's being used to do the experiments in
this
our laboratories.
This is the atom collider.
This is a collider, yes. Yeah. This is right.
This is the most expensive scientific instrument ever built.
This is the most expensive scientific instrument. It's billions of dollars.
Geneva.
Near Geneva, the one in Geneva. Switzerland.
Oh, CERN, sir.
CERN.
I have been, yes. I've been there.
Yeah. You've been there.
I think 73. There I learned the concept of quark.
Quarks.
Yes. Quark number one, number two, number three.
Here are the quarks.
Then I think number fourth or fifth, not yet found.
Not yet discovered
so
at that
then,
time.
I think now because
everything has been discovered.
Almost 30 years has passed. So
even
any
the Higgs
change?
Boson has been discovered.
Then that's how the Higgs boson said the
I'm going to end this talk in just a couple of minutes. But I want to end it with a very different set of pictures. Keep going forward. Yes, that's right. Keep going forward in your... this is an image of the sky. You can see the night sky. If you wait and are patient, you'll notice that the stars move overhead if you go out each night. What are you seeing when you see that motion? Are you seeing the stars moving, or are you seeing the earth move? Right? In fact, you're seeing the earth move, rotating. When the sun and the moon set, the earth is rotating. It looks one way, but we now understand it is another way. Now we've had a chance to travel with satellites and probes into the solar system. The picture at the bottom here is an actual photograph taken by this explorer here, this robot, of the landscape of Mars. This is the rocket which took it all the way to Mars, taking many years to get there. Here's the photograph of Mars. You can take also that same type of system in the Cassini satellite and go by Jupiter or Saturn and take photographs of this remarkable planets. And out of the cosmic exploration that we've had, both from the standpoint of theory and the standpoint of observation, we now have a much fuller and more adequate understanding of the universe. However, there are always new questions, and I want to just mention a couple. What we've discovered recently is that only 4% of the universe, that's less than a twentieth of the universe is made of normal matter, like this matter here. We don't know what the other matter is. We just know it can't be the same as the matter that we know. So 96%, most of the universe, is either what we call dark matter or dark energy. Also tomorrow, I'm going to talk to you specifically with Michel Bitbol about the mysteries of quantum mechanics.
Arthur, you might want to explain why,
how did we deduce that?
Yeah.
Sure.
Is it because of the gravity?
What you have are galaxies. Dark matter and dark energy are two different things. If you take a galaxy, which is billions of stars,
The galaxies.
A galaxy, yes.
Billions of galaxies.
Billions of stars. Billions of stars. And you watch it in its way in which it rotates, and you take what are the laws of physics and astronomy, and you count up all of the stars and estimate all of the mass in that galaxy, you find that it's too little. All of your calculations, your best estimates and observations is too small. So there is dark matter holding that galaxy together through gravity.
So compare that, much easier experiment here.
Yeah.
Much closer.
Dark energy is a little harder. There you have to have supernovas, which are exploding stars.
Right.
And those exploding stars become like what we call them standard candles. They become a measure, they allow you to measure distances. And what we've found is that as opposed to the universe collapsing or slowing down, it's actually expanding at ever faster and faster rates. And so there must be a kind of anti-gravity, a substance which is an energy which, as it were, pushes things apart at very large scales, at very great distances. So you have in these two remarkable and recent discoveries, then the discovery of the vast majority of the universe, we don't know what it's made of. We don't know this new matter or the new energy. So there's still something left for us to do when we come back in our next incarnation. You can be the physicist, and I'll come to Drepung. Thank you, very much, Your Holiness.
Thank you, Arthur.
Pleasure.
Wonderful. Wonderful. So now, if you could trade seats, we're going to hear from John Durant. Your Holiness, you may know John Durant's wife. John Durant is a distinguished scholar in his own right. He is a professor at MIT and runs the museum at MIT, a wonderful facility, and has for a long time studied science and the understanding of science in the public. So he is not only a scientific thinker, but he also thinks about understanding and misunderstanding of science. So he brings a wonderful perspective. But he also happens to be married to Anne Harrington, whom you have met many times.
And Harvard, Harvard, Mind and Life, Harvard University, Mind and Life,
And she was unable to be with us today, so he has come in her place. He will also be lecturing tonight and tomorrow night on his own work, but he's filling in for Anne Harrington, his wife, in this talk. So, John, thank you.
So, am I being heard? Yes.
Yeah.
We need to find the presentation called Harrington. Please, thank you.
Maybe he needs some
John,
help.
Can you pull the mic slightly closer to you?
Yeah. Yes. Yes, I've got it, thank you. So, great. Your Holiness, it's a great honor to be here. But as you have just heard, I am speaking on behalf of Professor Harrington, my wife. So she produced this talk. If anything in the talk seems wrong, it is my fault, not hers.
I thought he was.
So blame the messenger in this case, please. So the.
You tricked him.
So the task which Anne was asked to take on, and which I will now undertake, is to summarize how Western science has tried to deal with the mind really since the beginning of Western science. So as we say on the slide, this is a very simple introduction to a very large set of issues. And I'm going to talk as a historian, and we will go very swiftly through time. There will be many risky generalizations, but I hope it will be useful. And it will, I think, touch on many themes that have already been raised, especially your comments about various kinds of materialism, older ones and newer ones. So I think the place that we want to begin this story is to understand modern Western science, which really grew up in the 16th and 17th centuries, as a project to understand material reality. And I think it is perhaps important to understand the extent to which that was a self-conscious decision by the leaders of early modern science. They knew what they were doing. They inherited ideas about the world from older Western sources, which combined what we would call mental and subjective ideas with what we would call physical and objective ideas in quite complex ways. This is true of the Greeks. It was true in the what's called the medieval period of the Western world. And one of the key things that marks the emergence of modern science is a decision to stop doing that, to stop mixing ideas to do with the mind and ideas to do with matter, and instead to try to focus just on the material world and on things about the material world that could be measured. We've already heard reference to measurement and its importance. And so the kinds of things that early modern scientists were interested in were many. I mean, we've put up a few illustrations here, rocks and lightning and plants and animals understood as physical objects, stars and planets. Arthur has just referred to some of these. Even the human body, there's a famous experiment being shown at the bottom left of this slide, an experiment undertaken by an English physiologist called William Harvey. He did the experiment on his own arm to try to demonstrate that the blood moves in a circle through the body, through the heart. And it's an experiment that you can do on yourself, anyone can do. It shows actually that the blood only moves one way in the veins. And it always moves in the veins from further away from the heart to closer. It's always going this way, never goes that way. And Harvey asked a brilliant question. If the blood in the if the blood in the veins is always going this way, where did it come from? How did it get into my arm in order to come back in the veins? And although he could not see it, he concluded that there was only one way the blood could get out into the arm or the leg. It must go in the arteries and get between the arteries and the veins. You cannot see any connections between arteries and veins in a human body or in any animal. The connections are too small to see. So as Jinpo was explaining, Harvey makes a hypothesis. He makes a theory that there must be connections between arteries and veins. Otherwise, the veins would all be empty, and they are not empty. So he infers the existence of a circulation by simple experiments on himself, but he is treating himself for this purpose as a purely physical object. And it's often been noticed that his primary theory, for which he's most famous, is the idea that our heart is a pump, which is a mechanical idea. He takes this idea from engineers and applies it to himself and comes up with a completely new way of thinking about this central organ. So I want to suggest that this is characteristic of early modern science. And as we've seen, I don't need to dwell on this, the early modern scientists extended our understanding of the material world by extending their senses. So here is another picture of Galileo's telescope. I want to, because I'm trained in biology, I have a bias. So let us look instead at the left-hand side of the screen where we see a Dutch biologist, if you will, a man with an almost unpronounceable name in English, Anton von Leeuwenhoek, who is the first person to use lenses to identify microscopic animals in water, things he called animalcules. And you see him at work top left. And then at the bottom left, you see a drawing of a flea made by the English natural philosopher Robert Hooke. Again, you can hardly see a flea with your naked eye, but through a microscope, it's a gigantic thing, and that is Hooke's. So there is immense curiosity here among these early modern scientists in all aspects of the physical world. And excuse me.
Egyptian civilization. Very ancient civilization.
Yes.
So some sort of discussion or some idea about these things.
Right.
what?
The very ancient Egyptian civilization, what kind of science?
How are they thinking?
His Holiness is wondering. Given the antiquity.
I don't know much about ancient Egyptian ideas of nature. They were very different from those even of the Greeks who were their near contemporaries. But nothing like this.
There is an interesting aspect to Egyptian and Babylonian astronomy and science. We have the planets, and the planets are spaced more and more distant from the sun. They had very careful observations.
That's true.
Of the movement of the planets against the fixed stars. So they had names for these special planets, we would call them. But they had no conception of a geometry of space. For them, these were, you could say, the gods. Mm. Right? So there was no abstract conception of space and distance and order. It was simply the movement of the divine beings in the heights. Yeah. They were also in their medicine, relatively superstitious. It was all around spirits and the magical invocation of spirits. It was elaborate, but very connected to their religious life.
Thank you. Well, I don't want to stay on this, especially because I'm getting into physics and I am not a physicist, and I have Arthur on my right, and this could be a problem for me. But I just could not resist, we could not resist putting up a couple of images of the work of Isaac Newton, perhaps the most famous of the natural philosophers of early modern science. And it's just another illustration of using techniques to analyze the material world in new ways. And so he, among other things, among many other things, is famous for having used a prism, a piece of glass shaped as a wedge, to examine the nature of white light, sunlight. And he showed convincingly for the first time that white light is a compound, it's a mixture of lights of different colors. And he was able to recombine the rainbow colors to make white light again. So, by the time we get to Newton, who is doing this work in the late 17th century, the new science is becoming quite self-confident because so many new discoveries are being made using these new techniques. But this all raises the question that we really want to focus on here, which is, in the middle of all this, where did investigations of the mind fit in? After all, we're getting better and better at understanding the physical world, but what about the mind? And by the way, this illustration is just to illustrate, this is actually a medieval illustration of one medieval theory of the mind, which held that in the brain, the spaces, which are called ventricles, which are filled with fluid, are the most important things. And you see three ventricles there, which are believed at that time to have been significant, not least with respect to the location of the soul, the immaterial, immortal part of people in medieval Christian thinking. So what is the answer to this question? The most famous answer to the question, where does the mind fit in for early modern science, is honestly nowhere. It sounds a puzzle, but that's the most common thing one could say. Mind doesn't fit in because it doesn't seem to be the same kind of thing as the material world that we're becoming better at understanding. And
Solon is wondering, this is more of a historical question, you know, when people are talking about things like nowhere. Yeah, about. Oh. So are they thinking, are they, their conception of mind that they're looking for, is it still tinged with the conception of soul, which is a kind of a theological
element? When I sorry.
Usually, if we feel, I see, I saw. So, consciousness, and I,
Rib. Identical. Rib.
No.
Identical.
Nowhere does this mind consciousness go in a soul.
So His Holiness is wondering, you know, when, say, for example, people concluded it's nowhere. I mean, are they thinking still in theological terms of the notion of soul, mind as a soul?
Many are. There are complex ideas. There's no single idea, but many people have a theological way of thinking about this, and the concept of the soul is very important. And it's also important for the thinker on this screen, who is the famous French natural philosopher and philosopher René Descartes. And Descartes is the philosopher who is very much part of
like
the... Okay, so Descartes is famous for many things. He was an advocate of the new understanding of the physical world, and particularly for a kind of mechanical philosophy. And I will illustrate that in a moment. But Descartes wanted to remove completely from the study of the mechanical physical world any consideration of the mind or the soul. And he does this explicitly so that we can at least understand him, because he's very clear. And he says basically the world is made of two different things, two different substances. There is the material world, which is now the province of what we call science, and there is the immaterial world of mind or soul, which has none of the same properties, and which is the province of something other than science. And this famous concept is often referred to as dualism, because it holds these two things so far apart. So this is not the only idea. I don't want to imply that Descartes' idea is agreed with by everybody. It is not, but it's a very influential idea. And it does, it becomes one radical response to the question, where does mind fit in? And the answer for Descartes is, well, it's a mystery, but mind only fits in very particular ways in human beings, because we have minds and we have physical bodies. So somewhere in us, somehow, these two things relate, but apart from that, they don't relate at all.
Now, he gives a specific place for where
he does. I'm coming to that. He does. Now, you just referred, Your Holiness, to the idea of the soul, and it is worth saying that Descartes' idea that the world of consciousness, mind, and spirit were separate, for some people this was, if you will, a comfort. It was reassuring for religiously oriented people who could say, well, then our traditional beliefs about human spirit, about human immortality, they are to do with this world of mind and spirit. And we can now accept everything coming from science, which is just only confined to dealing with the physical world. This image is taken from a Scottish gravestone, and it's only there because it shows an image of the soul of the deceased person rising to heaven. So the wings and the head are the wings of the immaterial soul after death rising to heaven. So if you were a Cartesian, you could say, well, that's the spiritual side of the person. Their physical nature has died and is in the ground.
Let it.
And this, I do want to emphasize, this is a very radical view. So, as Christoph has just indicated, Descartes thought hard about how the physical human body works. He's showing here on the left a diagram of what might be happening if you put your hand or your foot near a fire and you withdraw. And for him, that impulse is an automatic mechanical thing. It's purely physical. And he even shows on the diagram how it might work in terms, for him, of the flow of fluids through nerves to muscles, which might somehow cause the muscles to change shape. But you'll see that this all connects up into the head, and it connects up at a place known as the pineal gland, where Descartes thought the immaterial spirit finally made contact with the physical body. And one of the reasons he focused on the pineal gland, he might just as well perhaps have focused on the amygdala, I don't know, but he focused on the pineal gland because it's a single gland where much of the brain is in two. And for Descartes, the spirit is not extended in space. It has no extension. So it can't be divided in two. So the soul could not connect through any of the duplicated structures of the brain. It must connect in one single place. And he chose the pineal gland. I want to emphasize, this means that for Descartes, humans are fundamentally distinct from other animals. Because for Descartes, all other animals are simply living machines. They have no soul. And so on the right, you see his a kind of diagram to illustrate how we are to think of a duck. And it's not that he thought a duck looked like that, but he thought a duck should in principle be understood like that, that it's a series of machinery connected together. The duck is thought to have no consciousness. It is not, for Descartes, a sentient being. Only humans are sentient. Voltaire, later in the 18th century, would ridicule Descartes by saying, you know, so we are to believe that throughout the entire universe and the entire world of animals, they're all simple machines, but just we, 5-foot-high human beings walking around, are somehow endowed with a completely different nature. And for Voltaire, this was absurd. So this emphasizes not everybody agreed with Descartes, but this was Descartes' view. And he took a similar approach to some of the issues we have been discussing even today. For example, thinking about vision. For Descartes, vision as a purely, what we would call physiological process, is purely mechanical. It's only when we come to bring our conscious minds to what we see that we can even think about consciousness. So you see a set of diagrams illustrating how the eyes receive an image for Descartes and how that might be reflected in movements of the hand to point to the image. But only if this is a conscious perception will the pineal gland be involved, at which consciousness is inserted. Now, I have said enough about Descartes, especially since my time is running out. The question is, what effect did he have? And Anne's thesis here for us to think about is that although people did not necessarily agree with Descartes, what he did was to push the problem of studying the mind scientifically into the background. So that for almost, well, for 150 years, it's possible to say, well, we get on with our natural philosophy and study the material world, and the mind is something different, and we don't know what to do about that. So, in a certain sense, and a number of historians have written about this, you can argue, I think, historically, that some of the success of modern science in the early period, by which I mean anywhere between 1600 and 1800, is bought at the price of putting the mind aside and saying, that's a separate set of problems. Let's deal with that later. And it's only really in the 19th century, much more recently, that this set of questions about the mind start to come back. Because for all sorts of reasons, people argue that we can't ignore it, and we don't really buy Descartes' view that the mind is completely separate. There were many reasons, I don't have time to describe them, why Descartes' ideas became less plausible, but they were always problematic. I mean, the biggest problem Descartes had, I think, was to explain how two fundamentally different substances could interact. How could this immaterial, unextended, immortal substance, the mind, have any possible influence on this extended material corpus body, and yet it's clear that it does, and he never said anything remotely convincing about how these two things connect. That was always a problem. But in the 19th century, there are many other problems arising. One of them is that ideas of evolution are beginning to arise, in which, for example, more people are coming to believe that animals and humans may be related, that they may be our literal relatives, in which case it's even more surprising that we have a whole element of our existence which is completely unrelated to them. So in the 19th century, the problem that Descartes had solved with dualism comes back to be addressed in a lot of different ways. And because I only have a few minutes, I'm going to summarize those very briefly. First, it is worth saying that some of the attempts in the 19th century to understand the mind scientifically now drew on methods of introspection, which today we associate much more closely with, for example, the Buddhist tradition. So there was a whole school of introspective psychology in the 19th century, associated particularly with a German psychologist called Wilhelm Wundt. And he tried to apply the same technique of classification and being precise to the study of, of conscious perceptions that had been so successful in the study of the physical world. So the idea here is that you take something like any visual object, I have an apple here, and you ask the question, what primary conscious percepts might there be associated with looking at the apple, perhaps its shape, perhaps its color, perhaps its taste or its smell. And he would bring human subjects into a laboratory which looked like a physical science laboratory. It's a very big breakthrough for psychology now to do this. And he would give people perceptual experiences, let them look at an apple, and ask them to report as accurately as possible what their conscious experience was. And he was looking to find a natural classification of conscious elements which went to build up our conscious experience. Wundt himself was unconvinced by what he did. It was very hard to get consistency of reporting between individual subjects, and actually quite quickly, introspective psychology was subjected to heavy criticism. That's a picture of a man called J.B. Watson, who founded a much more influential school of behaviorism, which basically said, you're going to get nowhere by relying on introspection. We must stick with what we can observe. And so we observe not the conscious mind, but we observe.
시신기 수술로야 자르체 디토네 개개체 동마레스테니 진남 요구토네 룽하게 죄베토네.
So Watson tries to shift the interest of psychology from introspected states of consciousness to observable behaviors, hence the term behaviorism for his branch of psychology. That is a second major attempt. I won't worry about the quote there. Psychology in the 20th century, experimental psychology, starts to do a great deal by way of setting human subjects various tests and tasks. This is another approach to the scientific study of mind, where you try to break down psychological abilities such as memory and perception, language or attention, into their constituent components by setting tests, which are usually quantitative in nature. And that gets a long way. But as another scientist who has participated in Mind and Life, Steve Coslin, has observed, I won't read the quotation, Coslin observes that one of the limitations of this style of psychology is that so long as you stick to the identification of psychological functions and how they work, you learn nothing about how they are represented in the brain. And so there has been a shift increasingly in recent decades to trying to finally get back to that physical structure, the brain, and analyze, as you've been hearing from other colleagues, how that supports mental life and particularly conscious experience. So I don't need to describe this. I think you know about this kind of work. This is an illustration of a much larger field, or maybe several larger fields of modern brain science, which use imaging, among other things, to try to, or recording of mental activity, to try to associate particular mental states with particular parts of the brain. There is a long history to that. It goes right back to the observation of the relationship between damage to the brain and changes in brain function. That image on the left there is a very famous one in brain science. It's the image of a subject studied by Pierre Broca, the French neurologist, of a man called Tan, who had an inability to speak. And after death, he was found to have a big lesion in his brain, now known as Broca's area. But in a
shebe koste lebe chaje damdaliya chawa damdaliya yoba chi mojin chi gor ta ti yoya ti lebe gyon yong ye tu to ne ani chawa madam la la la
so there's a consistent theme through a great deal of recent brain science right the way from that work in the 19th century to the latest brain imaging work which is trying to get more and more refined about the relationship between what is going on in people's conscious minds and what is going on in the brain. And others will speak much more to this. I will skip over it in the interests of the next talk. I just want to notice that this is all an attempt to produce a unified account. So the question that is raised by all of these efforts on behalf of modern science is whether after 400 years we are close or not to an ability to relate mental events to brain events in ways that would end this tradition of dualistic thinking. That's a question. Some people think the answer to that question is yes, we are close. This is a famous representative of that view, Patricia Churchland. I won't read the quotation, but she thinks that in the end it will be possible to give
California,
a consistent...
California, then it might have never been a job.
Ah, yes.
She was a participant at the Mind and Life in California.
Yeah. So this is a tradition that she represents of trying to understand the mind as a function of the human brain, but she knows that many folk disagree that this will be possible. There are people out there who just are skeptical that this will ever be possible. On the basis of modern science. And we're still left today in a scientific perspective with what a lot of people call the hard problem, which is why we have the basic subjective experiences that we have. These are things that Anne likes to use to illustrate this hard problem. These are pet rocks, which apparently are sold. And of course, it's an absurd idea to have a pet rock because you can't really have a relationship with a rock because it doesn't seem to be a sentient being. And and even putting little false eyes on them doesn't make them sentient beings, really. There's a philosopher in America who likes to talk about the problem of sentience by asking the question, what is it like to be that? And with a rock, I think we would probably all agree, it's not like anything to be a rock. You don't have any inner life that would allow you to say, to be a rock is a bit like being this or that. We probably do have good reason to think that it is like something to be a bat or a bird. And actually, Nagel wrote a famous article about the bat to illustrate this argument. And it's still an open question in Western science whether the techniques we are using are going to end up enabling us to crack the problem of why it is like something to be a sentient being. That is still an open question in Western science. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, John. That was wonderful. I'm going to move us right along because we have only a half hour left. We have one more speaker, and I wanted to protect a little time for her. As Wendy Hassenkamp moves up to the computer and finds her talk, I just want to say that the Mind and Life Institute is very fortunate in having recruited Wendy as our Director of Programs and Research. She brings training and expertise in both neuroscience and contemplative studies, which is a wonderful combination, the two worlds we're bridging with Jinpa's bridge. She also has had experience as a graduate student at Emory in educational programs with Tibetan monastics here in India. So she has a unique and wonderful blend of background and experience to bring to this enterprise, and we're so glad we saved you a little time this afternoon.
Thank you. Is the mic on? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Diana, and thank you so much, Your Holiness. It's an honor. It's a real privilege and a pleasure to be here. As Diana said, I've spent some time the past few years with the Emory Tibet Science Initiative teaching monastics at Sarah College, so this is a real joy for me to be here at this historic event where this is being offered now to a larger audience. So it's my task in the remaining time to this. I'm sorry?
Yes. Yeah, it's fine. It's fine.
Oh, okay. Okay. What I am going to try to do today is offer a little bit of background information for the larger monastic audience that may not have any science background, like Your Holiness has, in relating to neuroscience. So in order to try to help them better understand the conversations that they will be listening to. So some of this information may be basic for you, but hopefully it will help them get a better understanding. So first, most basically, what is neuroscience? What are neuroscientists interested in studying? And at a basic level, it is the study of the nervous system in our bodies. So the nervous system includes the brain, which of course is what you hear most talked about. It also includes the spinal cord, which comes out of the base of the brain through your spine, and is connected through many, many nerves throughout your entire body. So your brain is actually connected throughout your entire body. And the nervous system performs many extremely important essential functions for our lives. It helps to maintain our own bodies, so all the regulatory systems, breathing, heartbeat, digestion, fighting disease, all these things that we don't often think about are controlled by the nervous system. It also allows us to operate within our environment, so that includes taking in information through our five senses about the environment around us, and then responding through behavior or other actions, motor actions, other behaviors. And in higher animals, such as humans, the brain also is what underlies our thoughts and feelings, emotions, complex processes like that. So obviously, the nervous system is an extremely important system for us to understand, and John spoke a little bit about why scientists believe that the brain is the main organ of the mind. So just to give some very basic information, a little bit of a tour of the brain for anyone who is not used to looking at it. The outer wrinkly part of the brain is called the cortex. Sorry, still hear me? It's okay. And the cortex is commonly divided into four different sections called lobes.
Bend it close to your mouth because they're having to turn the gain up to you.
Oh yeah,
well, that's what's happening.
Okay?
Yeah.
Better?
Sorry. Yeah, that's good.
Okay.
Should be good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Sorry. So the brain is divided commonly into four different sections called lobes. And there are many different functions associated with these regions. The frontal lobe is associated with motor control, motor action, and also a lot of higher cognitive functions, such as evaluation, decision making, also regulation of our attention, language processes, and Richie this morning was talking about the prefrontal cortex, the most frontal region of the brain, and he was relating that to our ability to engage in mental time travel, so thinking of the future, thinking of the past. All of these higher cognitive functions happen in this frontal region of the brain. Behind the frontal lobe is what we call the parietal lobe, and this is involved in our sense of touch, touch perception, and also integrating a lot of sensory information from other senses. On the sides of the brain are referred to as the temporal lobe. This is involved in processing our sense of smell and our hearing sense of sound, and also some visual systems of processing specific information like faces and scenes. And at the back of the brain is what we call the occipital lobe, which is primarily devoted to vision. It's a very important sense for humans. There's a lot of the brain devoted to it. Underneath this large outer cortex is called the cerebellum. This is a specialized region that's involved in regulating your balance and coordination of movements. And it's also recently been understood to also be really involved in attention processes. And again, we see the spinal cord coming out of the base of the brain, which serves as the connection from the brain to the entire body.
Yeah. Never.
So his holiness is is aware of the fact that it has been discovered that even though certain regions of the or part of the brain is damaged, over time, the specific functions of those damaged brain, damaged part of the brain can be taken over by other regions. So with relation to, for example, speech, so if the speech part of the brain is damaged, and are there any specific areas which are correlated so that function of that could be taken over by another specific brain area, or is it
more particular area, or overall,
or is it just an overall remedial process?
You don't have a mind.
I think on the age or at which it happened. If it happens very early, like in childhood, there's some children where they have a tumor and the tumor is removed from the language hemisphere and they stop talking, but within a few months they can start talking again because they can transfer the language processing from the left to the right. But if this would happen in me, at my age, I would not be able to recover speech. If I had a stroke here, if it's big enough, I would be left aphasic. I could not talk again.
So my point is,
His Holiness is. So His Holiness' question is the following: that the fact that there is such a phenomenon is uncontroversial, but the point he's asking is: are there determinate sites which can take over the functions of specific damaged, specific parts of the brain?
For the clarification, see, another sort of part, damage, then, not the area which,
To kind of recover now. So His Holiness is wondering whether are there, for example, if someone loses language as a result of damage to that language part of the brain, is it always the case that there is a specific part of the brain that can take over that function?
There could be multiple parts of the brain that could take over. So there's not a specific part of the brain that will always take over. It's also the case, Your Holiness, that in my opinion, and there may be some differences among scientists here, but there have been very few tests of the further limits of human plasticity. And to give one specific example, there is a very important study that was done a number of years ago with patients who had a stroke where half the body was paralyzed because of damage to one side. And they treated these patients by putting the side of the body that was paralyzed in a whole body cast. So they immobilized the side of the body that was healthy. And they immobilized it for 16 weeks. So they lived in a cast 24 hours a day for 16 weeks. And what they found is that there was dramatic improvements on the other impaired side that they hadn't seen before, because the other side was the brain was forced to rewire in a way which conventional treatments had not yet achieved. And so I think that this study raises the question about the limits of plasticity and what may be possible. So does that mean that, say, for example, like the functions like mobility came to be restored to a point?
Yes.
So Dr. Doty is a neurosurgeon, so he operates on the brain.
So it's interesting. What I would comment on is, in part, it is due to the injury itself, and in part, it has to do with the ability of the person. You can see individuals, an example, who have a stroke in their speech area, who do not ever get it back. You see people, though, who extend an immense, immense amount of focus and effort and can have dramatic improvement. I think the other thing you see, which Tanya and I were just chatting about, are individuals who are blind, yet you look at what is nominally their area for hearing, and it gets much bigger. So there is this capacity.
So does that mean that the localization of the functions of different brain regions are not that determined, not that definite? Mm-hmm. So in that sense, when we talk about these different parts of the brain in functional terms, we cannot speak in absolute terms.
That's true. Right. That's absolutely true. So once again, Your Holiness, you have five neuroscientists scratching their heads, wondering how to answer your question. So another good question, but we must give the floor back to our speaker.
Well, what I would just say is that we do know that there are fairly specific areas in the brain that are associated with function, but they are not absolute. There is variability. As an example, a person could have a stroke in what would traditionally be expected to cause aphasia or inability to speak, but in fact it does not do that at all. And what we see when we look at functional imaging is that their speech area is actually a little bit away from where we would have predicted. So there is this area of variability. The other interesting thing that we are now exploring is a concept of neuroprosthetics. We can actually put electrodes on the surface of the brain and teach individuals how to independently move objects, if you will, using computers that are connected to this brain interface. So there are some extraordinary possibilities there in the future. But as I think Dr. Davidson had pointed out earlier, based on the complexity of the brain, we are mere infants in our understanding of the brain. So although it may be a bit silly question, so although it may be a little bit of silly question, but you know, we were talking about restoration of speech in individuals whose speech sites are damaged. What if, in theoretically speaking, we just completely take it out? I mean, is there the individual.
Can
the speech be recovered?
It depends on the age and many factors.
Yeah.
Small or big.
Yeah.
The chong yiga ko ma go da. The kind of chi kudu ke ni ba jang sa de la ba le ba ye che. Yun di su su pa ge ma ge jia de ba de pa ge jia de ba. Tin zan tin de ge to ne ya chong yiga ko na ma to chong chi ko na ya ko le ba xin da de che du ba. The de ge ke ban du le sa to. And it's chijung ko ma go da.
One thing we know for sure is that that part of the brain would not begin to speak.
That and the Kobe and Kyun Shosa Gileba Dich Hashigtone, Kesia Tumaris, that the lap tourist.
So even there,
the speech site must be a very complex site with a lot of different networks.
Yes.
So you can have a damage in one part, as opposed to having the whole thing removed.
Yes.
So what theoretically speaking, what if you take both sides out? Then you can't.
More problems.
In general, if both parts of the brain are removed on both sides, in general, you.
you are much less likely to recover function than if it's only unilateral.
Okay. So you need some basis. So in a sense, even though this individual has a damaged brain, but even the damaged part is doing some function.
Something like become weaker, so you need some sort of the cooperation.
Support, yeah.
Yeah. And it's
basically
yeah.
that damaged part still
working on some function.
It depends on the damage. Yeah. And that's oftentimes the surrounding tissue that will take over the function. Yeah.
That is dead.
Yeah.
If the cells are dead.
Right. Okay. Sorry. Yeah, excellent question. Okay. So inside of what you can see on the outside of the brain, the cortex, there are other structures that are also very important. And I just want to point out a few here because I'm sure that you will hear a lot more about them later in the week. Many structures here are known as the limbic system, and they are very important for our emotional life. One of these structures seen here is called the hippocampus, which has been implicated very strongly in memory processes. And just in front of the hippocampus is the amygdala, which Richie was talking about this morning, which is a very important area for emotion processing. So I just want to point those out for the other monastic students so they have a sense. Okay, so now that we've talked about the large structures of the brain, I want to go to a very small level and talk about small structures, about how the brain works. So a cell is the basic structural and functional unit of all living organisms. So everything that is living is made up of cells. And different organs and different parts of your body have different specialized cells to perform different functions. And the brain is made up of many different kinds of specialized cells, as Richie mentioned this morning, and the primary kind are called neurons. And the job of neurons is to send and receive signals through electrical and also through chemical forms of communication. And just for the monastic audience, I will put a few terms here, not to bog you down in terminology, but in case you hear these words so you can understand what's being discussed. There are certain parts of neurons that have different names. So there's like tree-like or finger-like structures at one side. Those are called dendrites. And the center of the neuron is called the cell body. This is where the DNA and all the machinery in the cell live and operate the cell functions. Then there is this very long part called the axon. This is what connects neurons one to another. And at the end is called the terminal, which is what sends the signal on. So neurons are very interesting cells in that their purpose is to communicate, and they communicate information in one direction. So the information comes in through the dendrites and the cell body and is passed along the axon, and the information goes out through the terminal. So let's look a little closer then about how these neurons work. I mentioned that they use both electrical and chemical kinds of communication. So this is a very simplified example of how this works.
The electrical, the chemical, neither form.
No.
Yeah.
So since there are two, in some sense, the kind of signals,
yeah.
You have the electrical and the chemical. Yes. So is it possible that in some cases one works and another is not working? One is damaged and the other
one can be damaged or interfered with, yes. So you could have problems with either side. So the electrical signals...
So where does these signals come from in terms of, yes. You know, what produces them?
That's a very complicated question. but it's basically a movement of molecules and ions across from inside the cell to outside of the cell. And that this causes an electrical signal, a voltage basically, to be generated.
One could even say it's locally produced within the cell itself.
Yes, that's true. It is in every cell, the electrical signal is locally produced, and it also contains the chemicals that are released. So the electrical signals are called action potentials. That's the term you may hear. This is also referred to as when neurons are firing, or brain areas are firing. So this is the electrical signal, just like electricity in the wires that you see, just like a spark kind of moving down the long axon. And then when that electrical signal comes to the end, it causes the release of chemicals, which are called neurotransmitters. There are many different kinds of neurotransmitters that perform many different functions. So this allows for much variability in the communication. And so how...
So this synaptic connections, does it also have some correlation to depressed states versus happy states?
Yes.
Research would suggest depressed people have different kind of chemicals, chemical imbalances compared to happy.
And so neurons are communicating one to another, or actually many neurons communicate to each individual neuron, and each individual neuron communicates to many, many neurons. So you could see that here, several neurons coming in, several neurons going out. So there would be electrical signals in the incoming neurons causing release of chemicals that sends various signals to this one neuron. That kind of performs almost a calculation of all the different signals coming in, and it may or may not send its own electrical signal, which would cause release of chemicals, and the signal moves on to other cells. So you can imagine how complex in a whole human brain this is, and we heard that earlier. The human brain is estimated to have 85 billion neurons or so, which is an extremely large number. And if you take, this is an example of a slice of a brain, if you take just a tiny part, 1 millimeter part, which Richie was discussing this morning, like the head of a pin, teeny tiny part, and you can apply chemicals under a microscope and look and visualize, this is only even a subset of the neurons. This is one of the first examples of when we were able to visualize the cellular and neuronal structure. You can see how complicated even in a tiny piece.
Larissa. Oh, that Jejangutunan. He's checking the Tibetan number. Because we have a name for single decimal
points.
Oh,
yeah, good. Very, very large number. So today we have more advanced techniques which can visualize different colors of that will show different parts of the neurons. And I don't really have time to go through this video that I want to show you. Maybe I can fast forward through it very quickly. But this is an example, also even, this is taken from a mouse cortex, which on a cellular level looks exactly the same as a human cortex. So when you come to the level of the neurons in the cells, there's really no difference between different animals. They're all same structure of the cortex. So this video will show different colors. Green is the dendrites and cell bodies. The blue is the axons, the long axons, and the red is the parts that connect. And if I can just fast forward, it shows better on the TV screens than the actual screen. But is it coming? Ah. So this is a, is it, okay, this is a video then, this is the slide I just showed up on the left of that 1 millimeter of tissue, and that pink square is coming down through. If you watch this screen here, you can see all the different colors of all the different cells. And it's showing the incredibly complex connections.
This is a magnified, or is it just a
more
artistic?
Yes, this is magnified, yeah. Very much, yeah. Yes.
It's real.
It is real, yeah, it's real brain.
Risha.
Shown close up. Yeah. So we can fast forward through different levels of the cortex. You can see this is mainly axons and some dendrites, and all those red spots are interconnections. Again, this is in the teeniest, smallest part of the brain.
It's thinner than a hair.
Yeah.
This thing is thinner than a hair.
And you can see if you come towards the end, you get down to very many connections, and you'll see some very large then, at least on this scale, large cell bodies and dendrites. And that's the center of the neurons right there. So you can imagine, this is in just one tiny slice, the thickness of a hair, this many connections. And then you can imagine the whole brain. So it's an incredible amount of complexity. It's quite beautiful.
These colors are added from the chemicals. The colors aren't real, but it's almost as complex as Buddhist philosophy. So we're at time. Perhaps I'll stop there and allow any comments or...
Good.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Hassenkamp. That was a wonderfully helpful review, and I think everybody will be grateful to have that as we go into greater detail tomorrow, pretty much, no, the next day, day after tomorrow. Yes. On Saturday, we'll go more deeply into these questions about the brain. We have a number of different experts, as we saw here, so it will be a fascinating discussion. Thank you so much. We are at our time boundary. It's time to break for tea. We're having, you want to have questions right now from?
After.
Oh, I was going to, yeah. So we will break for tea. Right after tea, we will come back here and at 4 o'clock for an hour and a half, from 4 to 5:30, we have an open space of time to hear questions from the audience. Everyone from whom you've heard today will be sitting here ready to answer any questions that have come up during the course of the day. So I hope you'll have tea and come back at 4 o'clock for questions and answers. So I'll let you go now for your tea.